this clinical grand round, which is much different as compared to the other grand rounds we have at AIIMS. And today what we are going to talk is something which is doable by each one of us, the faculty, the residents, the nurses, at the workplaces, wherever we are working, because at AIIMS we have the best health system with the best faculty members and the best nurses and the resident fellows who are providing care to the patients. So there can be no other place in this country where such an initiative for improving care for patients can be started. And this grand round is on quality improvement of care within the resources we have. And I'm so happy to see Madam Bhargava sitting here, because it was at Sitaram Bharti on 8th of August, it was our first contact with Peter Lashman and their group, who were doing quality improvement initiative in UK, and they wanted to bring it to private public hospitals. Madam, welcome, and we are so happy that you are sitting for this grand round, and we committed at that meeting that we will start doing this activity at AIIMS. And I can tell you this would have not been possible without the force of our director, Professor M.C. Mishra. He wanted this to happen, and he saw to it and motivated all our teams who are doing QI work in various departments to initiate QI projects. Not only one, do multiple, don't leave it, motivate more and more people so that they start taking this and embed this into their health system wherever they are working. So to begin with, I would request Professor Mishra to say a few words about quality improvement, how it is in context of AIIMS, how it is important, sir. Please, sir.
Let me take this opportunity to wish everyone a happy new year, and I welcome Professor Sneha Bhargav. Kindly give a big round of applause for her presence. She was, in her time, was considered the most dynamic director and most frightful director, if I may say so. When we are talking about quality improvement or quality assurance, that is something we are doing it for whom? Anurag, for whom we are doing this?
Patients and our students.
For ourselves. For me, for you, for everyone. Because when you are a user, you see quality with a different perspective. When you are a provider, you see with a different perspective, and many a times, when a patient complains, you don't like it. Nobody likes it, being criticized. It is a human nature, human side. But if we develop a system where people have least reason for complaint, that is what we are talking about. Whether as a user we go to a library, we don't get a book we like, or we are looking for a book on its shelf, we complain to the librarian. When we go to academic section, if some of your paper or request has not been processed on time, or faculty cell, or for account section, there your check is not ready on time. And when it comes to the hospital, naturally the hospital has to be patient-centric. Everyone here in this hospital is for the patient, by the patient, of the patient. There is no denial of that fact. And we should keep the patient at the center of everything. And that is what quality improvement or quality assurance is all about. Dr. Anjan Trikha is here. I wanted him to be in this grand round. Some time ago, he narrated a small story where he worked in New Zealand for 2 years. He said, sir, you were discussing about mistakes, errors, which we commit every day. If you look into your heart, we all of us have committed mistakes while taking care for the patient. It may be a different thing that patient was not harmed by that mistake. But many a times patients are harmed and harmed irreversibly. That also we know. So he narrated a story that he was, naturally he's an anesthesiologist, so they were anesthetizing a patient, and a medicine was taken out from a vial with a latex cap on it, with a needle and syringe. And when the medicine had already been given, then somebody pointed him to that this patient was sensitive to latex.
All centers, please mute your mics, please.
That should he report this to the hospital or should he not? Patient was not harmed. And his resident there, New Zealand resident, asked him, sir, should we report it? In India, in this hospital, how many of you would report it? Even if you don't raise your hand, I would say none would report it. That is the state in India on quality improvement or quality assurance. That we are scared. We are afraid that some action will be taken. But if the patient has not been harmed, why the action will be taken? It is for corrective mechanism for future. If we do not report it, then this mistake will be committed again. Patient will be harmed. And that is the reason every time we talk of quality improvement, we are compared with airline industry. That how they have developed SOPs over a period of time where chances of mid-air collision has gone to zero. They may come to very close, near-miss situations are there, but the collisions are not happening every day. Otherwise, if you see how the aeroplanes are flying in the sky, you will wonder why they are not colliding. And that is something which we need to talk about. And we have to upfront take this issue of quality assurance, because when we come as a patient, we want best of it, but we don't want to give it when it comes to the patient. And that is something we need to consider and work proactively towards improving quality of our care. Everybody is they work in their comfort zones, that what we are doing is great. But in the other's eyes, it may not be great. So it has to be a neutral person has to say that what you are doing is great. We should not be saying that we are doing great. And that is something which I suppose that is what we are going to discuss. And I am sure we all will enjoy this and take this quality improvement program at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences and its centers to the next level, and this will be a set role model for rest of the country, for public hospitals, that this is doable, this is possible, and if there is a will, there is a way. So I would request Dr. Devrari to lead. He has been the surprise finding for me when I saw, and I give credit to Mr. Abhishek Bhartiya, who is not here, his wife is here. Saru is here. He is CEO of a small hospital called Sitaram Bhartiya Hospital, and he invited me in August that there is a group from UK has come. So if you would like, so I was traveling and came back the same day, and I went and attended a workshop which was going on in Sitaram Bhartiya. But then Dr. Devrari spoke about that this is something which we should be doing, and he was already doing something on it. That was something very exciting for me as director, what more I could ask for, and what he has been able to do without asking any funds from me, without asking any manpower from me, which is even amazing. So please welcome Dr. Ashok Devrari.
I think what I would say is, this is my wish. And my wish is that most of us can use a structured approach to solve common problems. These problems are enormous in front of us. But what we do is we don't look at them and keep our brain open. So they are not existing for us. And if you start looking for it, you will find there are huge numbers. I'll give you an example. Example is, patient is admitted in emergency to the emergency ward. Investigations are sent, and there is delay in getting the reports by the resident or the fellow, which has to initiate treatment on the patient. And this delay certainly can be reduced if you look at how much there has been the delay for that report collection. Simple example. There may be patients in the ward who are following surgery, staying for a longer duration. And the reason for that is patients are having hospital-acquired infection or wound infection. And the simple thing which we need to fix it, that we need to follow hand hygiene and all precautions and asepsis for surgery so that our patient and the client goes home early. We save money. We have the bed for another patient who can be admitted. And then this is so easy to be done. So my wish is all of you, at the end, there are many young resident doctors and the UG students also should start taking this as that they can do small QI projects at the places where they are working, make a team, and then start doing QI work. Show it to the other people that you also can get engaged into QI work. I am going to talk a little bit about quality of care, quality assurance, and quality improvement. What is the difference between these few terms? Quality of care focuses on how healthcare is delivered to the patient. And as sir said, patient is in center for getting that healthcare. And there are six elements to quality. And these six elements are that it has to be patient-centered, it has to be timely, timeless. That means the patient meets the doctor in time, the right physician who is able to give safe treatment without doing any harm to the patient. And then it is a system which is an efficient system, which saves money, resources, and times, and an efficient utilization of your resources in the hospital. That is our duty. Our government money is taxpayer money, our money. So we need to use our resources, and then equity of care. Rich and poor need to get the same treatment by the same level of expertise by the physicians and the faculty. And that is best practices, effectiveness, which has to be given to the patient. So this is the big umbrella of quality. And the quality comes into two main arms. One is called as a quality assurance here, and this deals with the health system, the manpower, the equipment, the supply, the computerization, all those things which are there in the health system to run. And then there is a component which is called as quality improvement. Quality improvement relates to changing the behavior, the way the physicians or the nurses work on the patient, and then slightly tinkering the health systems. So that is what is quality improvement. We are lucky at AIIMS for quality assurance. That means for the health system, we have all the input indicators which are in place. And what we need is, we need to do now quality improvement. The quality improvement is in the hands of healthcare professionals, the doctors, the nurses, and even the class 4 employees who work there, or the physiotherapists, or a technician who is there. It bridges the gap between what we know and what we do to the patient. There is huge amount of gap between that. And this gap is bridged by doing quality improvement. Because if you don't do the things right way, the patient is going to show you the output, some adverse event which is going to happen. Medication error is another simple thing for which quality improvement initiatives can be inbuilt by each one of us at all the places where we are working. And as I said, it has to be done within the existing resources. And how this can happen within the existing resources? This can only happen if we have leaders and the faculty members who are senior who drive their team. It has to come from within. The intent of the people has to be that they are looking for some problems which are there and they want to fix it. And they choose a problem which is easy to fix. Show it to the other members that you can fix it without asking money. And then pick another problem and then again fix it. Problems are enormous. But to make a sustainable change for quality improvement, occasionally you may need little resources to tinker the health system a little bit, and then it becomes a sustained effort on the part of the team, and the team feels very happy. And as I said, you have the inputs which is there. We know at AIIMS with the best faculty and the residents and the fellows and the nurses, we know what the standard of care has to be given to the patient. We make guidelines for the entire country. We know what the content of care has to be for the patient care. But the problem is here, this gap, how this is done. And a great example is many times a procedure is done and there is no checklist which is followed. And if you don't follow a checklist, event is in front of you. And that is what the output will show you. So as I said, we have the best in place here, and we are the luckiest people on this earth, especially in India, I can tell you. Go to the district hospital or a medical college. See how the health systems there are in shambles, and how demotivated the staff is there. What we are seeing here is everything which is given to us on plate, and we need to work better to make this care better. So there is a model of improvement which was given in 1992 by Langley, and he said there are three core questions which has to be asked for while you do quality improvement. And these questions are answered by doing cycles for a change, which is called as a PDSA cycle. Plan, do, study, and act cycle. You will learn about that very shortly by the team members. The first is, what are we trying to accomplish? That is our aim. How will we know that change represents improvement? Unless our team knows that you are doing something, there has to be a measurement, which has to be robust measurement, which shows that you are doing better. This is the evidence which you create. And then, what changes will result in improvement? Take an example. You may fail by making a change. So you just abandon that change. If your change works for improvement, you adapt that change into your system. If you think it needs a little bit of adaptation, adapt it and take it into the system, embed it into the system. This is how a continuous cycle of QI, quality improvement, can be established in a workplace wherever you are working. Now, the steps in quality improvements are very simple, and these are listed here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm not going to talk about this because the teams are going to share with you how these quality improvement steps they have done in their departments and shown us with the results that their improvement can happen by making changes at the workplaces what they were doing. For doing all this, what we did was, we did the first workshop on 22nd August, in which we trained 12-6 teams, doctor, nurses, nursing tutors, gave them some projects. After a 5-hour workshop, they came back, they presented the project, they were handheld to make a presentation again on the third workshop, and then finally in the fourth workshop they presented their work and shared with another 6 teams. And today here we are with you to share that experience of quality improvement work, the success story from the various departments. And to share, we can't share all, but 3 success stories are going to be shared by the teams. The first one is from RP Center. It will be presented by Dr. Parijat Chandra. He is additional professor in RP Center. And you will see all those steps of QI are followed there. The second one is going to be from obstetrics department. Dr. Seema Singhal is going to make presentation. She is assistant professor. And from neonatology, we have a nurse educator, Meena Joshi, who works in the NICU. She will make a presentation of the project which she has done. So let me invite first Seema to, Parija Chandra to make a presentation. Parija.
Basically, we did the QA project to reduce the waiting time in general anesthesia waiting area for inpatients by 50% in 4 weeks in a single operation theater of RP Center AIIMS. So when you basically see, we were operating 3 cases at a time in the GA OT at any one time, but a large number of children was waiting in the GA waiting area. Basically, the whole GA waiting area used to be totally full. It was unnecessary crowding, chaos, with hundreds of patients sitting on the floor, difficulty in patient coordination, increased risk of infection, prolonged fasting period, a lot of anxiety among the child and the attendant. So we did the QI project to collect the baseline data in a single pediatric retina OT. We basically operated, most of them were retinopathy of prematurity, preterm baby surgery was done in these OTs. So basically we had external teams which calculated the time of the patient movement from the ward to the OT and outside. And the waiting time was basically set when the patients reached the OT reception area, which was outside the OT, to the OT GA recovery area, which was inside the OT, and was eventually shifted inside the OT. So what we saw in the baseline data collection was surprising on the first day. All the 8 patients were called before 8:30 a.m. The anesthesia people come at 8:30 a.m. So all of them, the patients already sitting for the entire OT list. 6 were called before 8 a.m. even before the OT opened. 2 patients were cancelled after 5 hours of waiting for a 5-minute procedure, and infected case for 6.5 hours. So we had an average waiting time of 3.5 hours, which was huge, and the maximum waiting time of 6.5 hours. This is all an eye-opener for us. Without this baseline data, we never have found out this was happening there. So just to show you the baseline chart of the process mapping which we did in our QI project. So GR basically called all the patients to the ward. Then the GR calls for the NICU bed, because these were ROP babies, so preterm babies for surgery. An ICU bed had to be arranged, so they used to then call in the morning, and there was a class in the morning, so there was some difficulty in organizing the bed in the morning. Then the patient leaves the ward, comes to the OT reception area, comes to the GA waiting area. If the surgery is on, then he shifted for surgery inside the OT. Otherwise, he waits for confirmation or cancellation and goes back to the ward. So clearly, 2 major problems were there, that, you know, all the patients were called, so we basically need to reduce the number of patients called from the ward, and we need to reduce the patients' waiting time for those who were cancelled. So in the phase 1 of the QI process, we decided that, you know, the GR will only call the first 2 patients and not all the patients. We decided that no calls will go out before 8 a.m. and only a single GR will call the patients, so that multiple people from different tables are not calling the patients and confusing the ward system. So this ensured that only 2 patients came into the OT in the morning, the rest stayed same. The GR physically escorted the patients out from the OT who were cancelled. Otherwise, a lot of patients kept on waiting for confirmation and just sitting there. So this had to at least reduce the waiting time of cancer patients. But because only the first 2 patients came into the OT, the GR called a 3rd case when the 1st case was operated and exited after surgery to the recovery. So it did make a lot of change, and we found that the average waiting time reduced by 44% and the maximum waiting time reduced by 50%. So this looked very nice, and we thought, you know, let's see what more we can do about it. So obviously there are a lot of more problems still there. The GR still had to call the NICU bed. 2 patients were coming, the 2nd patient had to still had a very long waiting time. The 1st patient waiting time had to reduce, the 2nd patient waiting time had to reduce. And if you need to do that, the patient had to move to the OT faster, the reception time waiting had to reduce. And if you really need to push it further, the intercase waiting time had to reduce even further. So we reworked the entire process again. You see, entire all the boxes became green. We tweaked the entire process. Now the GR only called the 1st patient into the OT. No calls were made before 8 a.m. Only single GR continued to call. And the PVAC was done for all the patients the previous day at a prefixed time, where we ensured all these babies were sitting there for the anesthesia people. The OT list was meticulously checked that the order stayed as it should have been, they were called. We did a small QI effort with the NICU team, and thanks to them we were able to create clearances at 1 fixed time 1 day previously. And the morning call went away, because we used to send the entire team, faculty and SRs, an email with what babies were posted tomorrow and whether they were cleared. And if anyone had an objection, they would send an email back, there was a problem. Otherwise, it was understood that the nursery cover was there for the babies. The NICU call, which wasted 30 minutes in the morning, went away. Then the patient had to leave faster, because, you know, only 1 patient was there. So suppose this patient is cancelled, the next patient might take a lot of time to come there, which the anesthesia people might not like. So the sister keeps all the patients ready in OT clothes, and the patient is advised to take stairs instead of the lift, which might take 10-15 minutes to come up. There is just two floors to climb, and we checked out that within 5 minutes the patient could be there from the ward to the OT reception area. So there was no need for more patients to be sitting in the OT reception area. Since the JR is free and there is no one waiting there in the OT reception area or in the GA recovery area, people continue to check in the reception area and these patients move much faster. Now, because only one patient was called for surgery, when should the second patient be called? We tweak the intercase time even further. When the first case surgery starts, then you call the second child from the OT. As I said, these are bilateral surgeries, so they take around time, around half an hour, 1 hour is taken for the surgical time. Plus, it's a GA OT, so the time for the GA is there. So the objective benchmark is kept. When the surgeon cuts the offside or the surgical drape, it means that is when the surgery has started. That is for the JR to see. So the anesthesia time, the draping time is all cut if you follow this. Sometimes both the child's eyes are operated in one sitting. Then the second eye, when it starts, then you call, and not when the first eye starts. If it's a multi-part surgery, for example, the keratoprosthesis with the vitreoretinal surgery, then don't do when the keratoprosthesis put. You do when the vitreoretinal surgery starts. So all this worked out very well, and let's see what happened. Yes, the time went down even further, and the average GA time came out, and the average maximum GA time also came down further. But this is not enough. If you really need, could we sustain these changes? It could be a one-time problem which we fixed. Maybe the patients were rested that day. Maybe some other issues were there. So the thing in QI project, we have to see if you can sustain the changes. So for the next few OTs, we could actually sustain the changes, and we did bring down the average GA time and the minimum GA waiting time. We could bring down across all these days. So GA, the QI did help to reduce GA waiting time. So small process changes and small QI measures, we could reduce the average GA time to a maximum 87%. Sometimes it came down to even less than half an hour. And we could reduce the maximum waiting time again by 87%. Sometimes it came down to even less than 1 hour. And the best part of the whole story was the same single JR who used to run this whole show inside the OT, the same JR with the small process mapping changes to independently sustain these QI changes and bring about a major change in patient quality of care. Thank you so much. Now I would like to invite Dr. Seema to come and present her question.
Now I'll discuss briefly how we at Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology were benefited by QI. The first step of QI is identification of a problem. We all know that separation of mothers from their neonates at the time of birth has become a routine standard practice. But there is enough evidence to suggest that this may have harmful effects on breastfeeding. And this widespread decline in breastfeeding is a major public health concern. So we wanted to work on establishing skin-to-skin contact as a standard of care in our labor ward. So what is skin-to-skin contact? It is basically placing the naked baby covered across the back with a warm blanket, prone on the mother's bare chest immediately after delivery, even before cutting the cord. It basically helps by providing sensory stimuli, and in response to that, there is release of oxytocin. And this oxytocin in turn contracts the uterus and thus helps to reduce maternal blood loss following delivery. It also raises mother's breast temperature, and this helps to reduce hypothermia. Apart from that, this oxytocin is also known to antagonize flight and fright response, and thus helps to reduce maternal anxiety and thus improves parental behavior and thus improves lactation. So our aim was to establish skin-to-skin contact immediately after delivery to an extent of 25% in 2 weeks in low-risk mothers who were admitted in our labor. Initially, this practice was not existent in our labor. So how did we start? First of all, we oriented our labor room staff, including our junior residents, senior residents, and our staff nurses and student nurses, regarding what is skin-to-skin contact, what is the technique, and how it can benefit both mother and baby. Apart from that, we also counseled all the pregnant patients who were attending to us in our OPDs in third trimester and also at the time of admission in labor. For that, we took help from various audiovisual tools like videos and posters. The next step was constitution of a team. Our team consisted of staff nurses, and doctors who were coming on duties in labor room, student nurses, and three designated faculty members from each of the units. And each and every member was designated specific duty. After that, we analyzed the data. We collected the data, and to begin with, we saw the practice was not existing, we were not doing it. And then we introduced skin-to-skin contact. After that, we can appreciate a lot of waxing and waning process. So our interim analysis was done in the first week of our introduction of SSC, and we could see that out of all eligible deliveries, only 61% of the deliveries were given skin-to-skin contact. It was encouraging, but still we felt, why not all the eligible patients were getting it? So for that, we did a root cause analysis, and we drew a fishbone. But with that, we identified there were four areas which were requiring intervention. One was compliance, then the standardization of our technique, then documentation, and of course, follow-up. Each of these areas were tackled separately in the form of PDSA. Now, let's take an example, compliance. We expected compliance on the part of patient and on the part of providers. To our surprise, none of the patients actually refused skin-to-skin contact. It was 100% compliance on their part. But in an interim analysis, we could see that lack of compliance was present in 40% of patients on the part of providers. So for that, we look for the reasons why it is happening. We realized that there was gross underperformance during nights. And the deliveries which were happening during the change of shifts, we were also not getting skin-to-skin contact. So for that, our team decided that, okay, at the time of change of shift, once overs are finished, we will give a call to labor room and we'll sensitize again the teams that yes, this is to be done. And this, of course, during the time of shift changes also, whatever deliveries were happening, the thing has to be done. So in the next analysis, we found that the lack of compliance was also reduced to 0%. The next area that we identified was standardization of the technique. Actually, it was a mistake on our part also because we initially did not specify the duration. So later on, when we realized, we specified the duration to 1 hour. But the problem which that was leading to was congestion in labor room. More than an hour, if patient stays there, it was leading to congestion. So to solve that problem, we decided that during the time where patient's physiotomy and everything is being stitched, baby will remain with the mother, but at the time of transfer to PNC ward, there will be some detachment from the mother, and then again resumption of the activity will be done in the PNC ward. So this led to improvement in our technique, and our average duration increased to 45.6 minutes. Similarly, we also worked upon documentation and validation of the SSC, so that it is followed in all the patients. Then again, we analyzed the data and we could see that our figures improved to 81%. Now the next challenge in front of me was to promote consistency. And for that, we planned regular learning sessions and frequent monitoring that skin-to-skin contact is followed in all the patients. And with that, we could maintain consistency. So by now, skin-to-skin contact is a standard of care for all eligible deliveries in labor room. Eligible deliveries basically means all those babies who were not requiring neonatal resuscitation. So these are the patients, and with this, we are probably able, will be able to probably target the ultimate aim of exclusive breastfeeding to all our patients. So I would like to conclude by saying that this project basically highlights the basic principles of QI, that structured problem solving to all the problems which are present in, around us and a team spirit. Thank you. And now I invite Ms. Meena Joshi to present.
So we did a project in maternal breastfeeding practices among babies in So as we all know that mother's milk is the best milk for a baby, and ideally all the babies should get mother's milk from birth at 6 months of age as per WHO recommendation. Formula feeding has been identified as one of the risk factors for the development of necrotizing enterocolitis in low birth weight sick newborns. In our nursery, we do give mother's milk to the baby, but In the time the mothers start producing enough milk for their babies, the babies are given formula feeding, and this period of formula feeding may vary from 6 to 7 days after birth. So the problem identified was, like, mothers whose babies were admitted in NICU, they started expression of milk only after birth. So the expression of milk in these mothers were delayed, and the frequency of expression of milk is also delayed, like including night. So day and night expression was less than 2 to 3 times per day. So the problem was bigger than we thought. So our aim was to increase the amount of breast milk intake in admitted neonates from 12.5% to 30% over a period of 6 weeks. And for this, we did a baseline data collection in 8 mothers. And what we found that in 8 mothers, only one of, initially they were not expressing milk during first 3 days, and only one mother was expressing milk in out of 8 mothers. And the rest of the mothers, they started expressing milk on day 3. And on day 7, when we studied these mothers, then we found that only one mother was able to give her breast milk to her baby, and rest of our babies, they were on breast milk, mother's milk, but other than mother's milk, they were given formula feeding. So it was a mixture of feeding, breast milk as well as formula feeding, but only one baby was able to get mother's milk. So you can see it here. So we did Fishbone analysis, like, what is the problem, why are the babies are not getting mother's milk? So the problem was that there was no EVA, and there were many barriers. We were able to identify many barriers, but the most important barriers which we were able to identify was that there was no early expression of milk. Why there was no early expression of milk? Because the mothers, they were not knowing that early expression as well as night expression can lead to increased milk output, so they were not doing it. And the second most important factor was healthcare providers related. Like, they were also not sensitized. Like, if the baby is getting formula feeding, they were also not that much, you know. Like, it is very much important to teach the mothers and also the lack of sensitization in the healthcare providers. And the third most important factor was no postnatal counseling. So, no postnatal counseling was done for these mothers. So, these were the factors which were causing no EVA in the mother. So we implementing our QI project, we planned PDSA cycle, and in this we planned a comprehensive postnatal counseling program for our mothers for overcoming the identified barriers. And then we involved 4 nurses, and we posted them in different shifts, and then we planned the content of the counseling. So the content of the counseling was videos on expression of milk. So every mother whose babies are admitted in NICU, she was supposed to look videos twice in a day, and then counseling, 1:1 counseling of the mother is done, and then relaxation technique was also taught to the mother. So we planned a PDSA cycle, and then we studied the results, and the results were outstanding, and they were so outstanding that this project is still continuing in the UK. So the results were, like, after intervention we started resulting 5 mothers. So as you can see here, that now we were able to get milk in first day, second day and third day, and the milk was quite increased on day 6. Whereas as compared to, like, here you can see the milk output started on day 1 itself. So as compared to previous 8 mothers where there was no intervention done, you can see that there was hardly any milk on day 1. Day 2 there was no milk at all, and they started expressing milk on day 3. But on day 6, if you compare, it was less as compared to post-intervention. So here on x-axis we had number of mothers, and y-axis we had amount of milk. So in 8 mothers we didn't do any intervention. So here you can see that without intervention we hardly able to get milk, and it was almost 0. And only one mother was able to give milk. And then here we did intervention in the form of complete comprehensive counseling, 1:1, showing videos, and then doing relaxation technique. And then after intervention, it hardly touches the 0. Even in one of the mother, we were able to get 30 ml of milk on day 1 of life. Then we did analysis on day 7 of life, and on day 7, as you can see here, before intervention, in these 8 mothers, like, we On day 7, we were hardly able to get more than 200 ml of milk, but after intervention, we were able to get as much as more than 500 ml of milk on day 7 of life. And the comprehensive counseling continued in the unit. So, proportion of unit fed on mother's milk, on week 1, only 12% babies were able. Like, our aim was to increase from 12% to 30%, but on week 2, we were able to achieve 60%. And on week 3, we were able to achieve 70%, and on week 4, 83% of our neonates were on exclusive maternity milk. So the results were mothers were able to express more milk, amount of EVM increased, and babies, like, we were able to get from 12.5% to 83% of our units were able to get mother's own milk, and the breast milk production increased on day 1, as well as amount of breast milk expressed also increased on day 7. So the conclusion is EVM express breast milk output increased following postnatal counseling. Early and frequent expression day and night help mothers to express more milk. These two changes resulted in early substitution of other mother's milk and formula milk by own mother's milk. Now, how we are sustaining it? The tips to keep it going, like, each sheet by taking over, we ask if any baby goes on other than mother's milk, why this baby is not on mother's milk, and we try to find out what is the reason. Then the primary nurse is milk is responsible for the early expression of milk and making it part of doctor's daily treatment order. Active involvement of faculty during rounds by asking the type of feeding the baby is on. And we have a NICU group, and we send SMS through that group and remind the team if any baby goes other than mother's milk, and continue comprehensive postnatal counseling in the unit. So this quality improvement approach helps improve care for the baby and reduce costs related to formula feeding. It can increase EVM feeding. It has already increased EVM feeding in our unit, and it also promotes early discharge from the NICU.
So, thank you. I think it is not only these three success stories. If you give them more time, they will share more QI projects they have done in the unit with the help of the faculty members who are mentoring at the places where they are working. So it is not stopping here, one, doing it more and more, and then motivating more people to take MSc girls to take projects on QI, which I know by names they are doing it, three more projects. So this is like a movement which is happening here. And I see there are a lot of young resident doctors and UD students who are sitting in the grand round. I feel that you need to learn a little bit about how to develop a QI project, but looking at the time, how the wall clock is clicking, maybe we'll be able to do one or two presentation of that and then go to listen from trauma center on quality improvement. So let me ask Richa to talk about problem statement and aim statement.
After listening to all the stories, now we come on how to design a QI project. So there are several steps in designing a QI project, starting from identifying the problem, creating a team, and making an aim statement. I will be dealing with the first three of them. So how to identify a problem? Now, the biggest problem lies in places where people don't believe they have a problem in the first place. Everybody says that our system is flawless, but that is not true. We should be looking into with an intriguing mind and think outside the box to know where is the problem. When you start thinking, then you will see, then you will find out there are multiple problems. Now, which one to choose? Identify a problem which is clinically important and easily amenable to change. Identify gaps in the quality of care. Choose what to improve if more than one gap exists. For example, if I want to reduce the incidence of ventilator-associated pneumonia in my ICU, I will look upon four things. What is the problem area? Is it the poor hand hygiene compliance? Is it the lack of head and elevator positioning? Lack of weaning protocol? Or poor selective oral decontamination? So try to start work on one area. Start with a gap which is easy, doable, feasible, does not require much resources like cost, and is valuable for the patient. For example, in this case, we can start either with a poor hand hygiene compliance, or we can start working on the lack of weaning protocol as a dish indication. Now, after you have identified the problem, the next step is how to make a team. Always remember, team means together everyone achieves more. Ideally, a team should be made of 3 to 5 members, and you should involve people from all the departments, all the disciplines. Suppose if I want to work on a hand hygiene compliance, I will make a team which consists of sisters, residents, faculty, and even sulabh karmacharis. The 3 most important elements of any team are: at least one person should be there who has the authority, who is the leader of the team. There should be clinical expertise. Every person on the team should be expert in his area, and there should be one project champion who is driving day-to-day progress. Now, after making a team, the next thing is to make an aim. Now, your aim statement should be SMART, S-M-A-R-T. SMART means it should be specific. What exactly do you want? Measurable, you should be able to see your response in terms of percentages or frequencies. It should be achievable, you should not aim for very high things. Always remember, small steps, they make big differences. It should be relevant for the patient, and it should have a timeline. For example, if I make a statement, I want to improve the compliance of hand hygiene in trauma surgical ICU. It does not have a meaning, it's wrong. Okay, and I can improve it to improve the compliance of hand hygiene among nurses, doctors, and other staff in a cubicle of trauma surgical ICU from 50% to 80% in 1 month time. It is specific. I want to improve the compliance among the nurses, doctors, and other staff. It is relevant for the patient care. It is measurable from 50 to 80%, and it has a timeline, that is 1 month time. All right. So this is the right SMART goal. Now I call Dr. Aparna for telling you about the quality improvement tools.
I think Aparna and Sindhu will do a slot from the CMAT and do a workshop on how to do QI project. I think it will take a long time. I'm requesting Amit to come over and share. We are doing in trauma center a quality improvement project for near miss and avoiding deaths for the patients. And it is a Indo-Australian big collaborative project. So Amit, over to you for 5 minutes.
Oops. Where are the slides? Are these slides or? Okay, well, I'll just quickly go through what is trauma quality improvement and how it's different from in-hospital normal elective quality improvement which we were just discussing. We know the need for trauma quality improvement is because it's a public health problem, not only globally but also in India. And globally, if you see the statistics, it is still concentrated. 80 to 85% of mortality of all injuries are in lower and middle income groups. And in India, the situation is really bad. About 400,000 injury-related deaths, out of which 150,000 nearly are from road traffic injuries. Generally, between the age group of 15 and 44, 80% are males, and therefore there's a heavy loss to the exchequer to the tune of 3 to 3.2% of GDP. Well, if we calculate one death equals 30 severe injuries leading to some sort of a disability and 70 so-called minor injuries which can put you off work for varied periods of time. And the important thing is all injuries are preventable, whether within the gambit of healthcare or outside healthcare, by primary prevention. And all injury-related mortality and disability are also preventable. And this prompted the WHO to actually formulate guidelines for trauma quality improvement. And it was different for trauma quality improvement because when you see trauma care, it is in a systems view. And the system in trauma care is not only the hospital. There are events happening before the hospital, from the time of injury till the patient arrives in the hospital. And there are events happening after the discharge of the patient, not getting rehabilitation, which have significant bearing on their mortality and morbidity. And secondly, all activities here are time sensitive. So from the time the person gets injured until the time he comes to the hospital, the time to hospital, the time to intubation, the time to ICD, the time to CT, everything is important. Therefore, somebody needs to be there in your emergency department who's actually real-time measuring those parameters. Otherwise, your quality improvement in trauma will not function. So you need to have a good, robust, outcome-based data, which is a trauma registry, which is the baseline for all quality improvement in trauma. And unlike elective hospital, in 24/7 emergency care, there's no controlled atmosphere. There are multiple teams working together, anesthetists, emergency physicians, trauma surgeons, neurosurgeons, orthopedic surgeons, and therefore, the propensity of errors happening in an uncontrolled atmosphere are much more. So how to you know sort of address that? And even if you see the American College of Surgeons accreditation criteria for a level 1 trauma center, apart from all the you know dedicated trauma service and surgeons teaching, training, research, trauma quality and performance improvement is one of the criteria. If you do not have a running PQI program, you cannot call your center a level 1 trauma center. Well, the new initiatives we took at the Apex Trauma Center was number one to have a trauma registry. It was the first in-hospital trauma registry in India, and the workers, the backbone for this trauma registry was a cadre of nurses which was called the trauma nurse coordinator. And in the world they are called by different names like trauma managers, trauma coordinators or trauma quality managers. But we call them trauma nurse coordinators, and they coordinate all activities not only within the emergency department but all the activities regarding patient care where multiple teams are involved. They also collect the data real time in the emergency department and therefore help us track any patient according to the timeline. And last, they also report critical incidents happening in the emergency department, which we found, and I'll show you, which we found really important to improve systems of care within the emergency department. Then finally, we also initiated department weekly audit, because trauma is a branch where mortality and morbidity occurs. We need to go back and study that mortality in detail if it happened, and also study the preventability of that mortality, whether that death was preventable or whether the patient would have died anyway. Through our various M&M conferences, preventable death panel reviews and radiology conferences. And finally, we formed a multidisciplinary committee which had the additional MS, the faculty in charge of trauma nurse coordinator system, various faculty from neurosurgery, trauma surgery, anesthesia, critical care, who would actually bi-monthly sit together and discuss the sentinel mortalities which were taken out from the weekly audits. And this would help go back and try to solve the puzzle and the problem. Well, we found that central incident reporting by the trauma nurse coordinators was a very effective way to improve quality of care in the emergency department. The incident reporting was not to blame anybody there, but just to improve quality of care, and therefore it was confidential in nature, and the incidents were reported to the faculty in charge, TNCS, which finally, I'll show you the closure of loop. And then it identified various problems like why does violence occur in an emergency department? What were the reasons behind it? Is the referral which is happening from other hospitals proper or not? There's so many other things which came out from these incident reportings. And what we actually divided them into 8 major groups, like inappropriate triage of sorting out the patient into red, yellow, green, inappropriate referral, violence, delay in review by various specialist doctors, delay in shifting to the OR, to the OR time, and other things like deviation from protocol and lack of awareness. So what we actually do is that the trauma nurse coordinator reports the incident to the faculty in charge, who in turn confidentially reports it to the medical superintendent and the concerned department faculty, whoever was there on call. And then finally, if we find that the incident is non-repairable or needs a corrective action, it is also informed to the chief of the center. We develop policies, protocols. We call residents, remediate them if there was any problem with the management or the protocol, and then finally we close the loop. So that's the cycle we follow for central. As a part of quality improvement and being the Apex Center, we are running this Australian Trauma Systems Collaboration Project, and one of the 4 interventions in this systems project is institutional trauma quality improvement program for hospitals. And as Dr. Devari said, that if you go to smaller hospitals or other hospitals other than AIMS, the situation is really bad, especially uncontrolled in emergency and trauma situations. So we have selected 3 other hospitals, one in Mumbai, one in Ahmedabad, and one in Delhi, in Chandra, And what we are going to do is that we are currently measuring what is currently happening to as trauma quality improvement program there. And we have clearly seen that there is an absence of structure. What we then do is initiate the WHO AITSC TQI workshop, where we tell them how to structure their TQI programs. And then finally, monitor those MNM meetings and preventable death panel reviews in those hospitals, and then finally handhold and try to monitor the sustainability of this program. So that's
thank you, Amit, for sticking to time. And briefly, over next 3 minutes, I'd like to share a few things more. QI is not like research. It is contextual. For you to improve, you get the results very quickly. It is not resource intensive. It is not like a big study which you have to do, where you need resources, money, and then it's quite possible. Whatever you create as an evidence in QI project, you will be able to spread it at the all other places where the situation and the health system is more or less. So you can spread it once you have shown that it works with you. And we learned large lessons. Whenever you do something like this, there are lessons which you learn. You know how to select a good leader and a champion who can take it forward. What are the qualities of that individual? I can give a lecture on that. So I'll just... And then you need a commitment from the top leadership, which is the mover for this. And we were lucky that Director Sir was very positive. And again to say, without Vinod Paul, my head of the department, supporting me, Ashok, getting into this, what I love to do, this would have not been possible. So Vinod has been another person who pushed me into doing all this. And then doing frequent learning sessions with the people of the QI team makes this going forward. And to us, it looks the way forward is we have to now start targeting the UG education, the undergraduate BSc girls, the medical students. There is already an online community, www.ihi.org, and we are lucky. AIIMS is the chapter of IHI for Asia region for healthcare, and there are sharing opportunities, workshops need to be arranged. We are going to start that very soon. There has to be some recognition and rewards which have to be given to people who do good quality improvement projects like you give for research projects. There has to be value for the QI project in the appraisal of people while they get promotions. What QI work you have done, how you have improved your system, where you are working in the institution for the last 4 or 5 years. And to share that world is moving towards doing QI audits for hospital deaths, stillborn babies in low middle income group countries. And if the world is moving that, we don't have to keep on moving, waiting. We need to do confidential inquiry. I know it is happening in many of the departments in the institute, but in emergency department and other places which is, where it is not happening, confidential inquiry, not for penalizing people, but learning that similar mistakes are not happening again, had to be done. And at this point, I would like to thank the partners. AIIMS is the big one. We were lucky to have US Aid Assist. I see Nigel sitting there with Praveen. Institute of Health Improvement, Abha Mandiratta, she could not come, her flight was delayed. And as I said, we have a chapter, Institute is a chapter of IHI. It saves $400-$500 for people for getting there, you get good resources. But Parijat Chandra is the leader for that. You have to approach him, and if you show sincerity, he's going to monitor you, how many lessons you take, how many certificates you achieve in the IHI. And then we are on social media. We are on Facebook for spreading QI among our own people. And as I said, all the QI teams and the administration of AIIMS, it is all due to them, it is all possible. And for helping us to learn all this improvement science a little bit, Nigel, Abha, Praveen were the foremost force behind. And we are looking forward. Even World Health Organization headquarters, CRO, and the SIF SS people taught us some nitty-gritty of how to do improvement work at the institutions where we are working. Thank you so much. We are right on time, but sorry, we have less time for questions. But House is open for questions and comments. So I put a mobile phone so people who are there on the other side on telemedicine can ask question on my mobile phone number, and I can put it here and people can listen. Can we connect to people? People from Jammu, from Ames Bhopal. Question. Ames Bhopal. Okay, so questions from the house or comments? Yes, Deepak, I forgot to tell. We should have done quality improvement in improving education for how the seminars are done by doing a bundled approach for doing a QI improvement. But you have a question? Thank you, Deepak, for so I think we are so privileged, Madam is here. We should listen to Professor Bhargav, some pearls of wisdom on some aspects of quality improvement. And? Oh, sure. Yeah. After Madam. Question or comment, Madam?
Just comment, just to congratulate you for doing this work, essentially bringing it to everyone's notice or awareness that this can be done without resources. That, I think, is the biggest message that you can give. It is the message that I would like to give. All this
is
can
possible.
Be done with awareness. And without any additional cost. And not only that, it is our duty to do that. We need to lead. You are the apex institution, and you have to lead. And Dr. Mishra is providing you the lead. You are taking the leadership on the floor, and I can only congratulate you.
Thank you.
And I'm sure you will provide the leadership to the country. Needs to be done. We all know healthcare is in a terrible state in our country, and we don't need any politician to tell us what to do. We need to do it ourselves. If we don't do it, we don't expect the politicians to do it.
Thank you.
Or to help us.
So, I think while we say no resources, resources here is the time of the faculty and the nurses and the people who do that project, but they are doing it in good faith for patient care improvement. Yes, Dr. Sharma.
No, I think it's a wonderful work what you are doing. Yeah. There is no doubt about that. It's going to have an act of implication, other departments also. Now, just want to, maybe you can look into the future whether the emotional component, like say, for example, patient satisfaction level.
Yeah.
Maybe, the family satisfaction level. Like you said that you reduced the time report. At the same time, what was the satisfaction? How they were satisfied they were. And if you can look into those emotional component also, it's very good. But those are lacking. Perhaps you can look into that, some of those aspects. In fact, though it was covered, other anxiety and some of those.
Fully agree with you. We have to take that patient's feedback on Likert scale and see what is happening. Fully agree.
Dr. D.K. Sharma, would you like to comment upon satisfaction? I think the hospital administration has done some studies, but not as a part of QI, but otherwise.
Thank you. And it is a very good suggestion. We can include the patient satisfaction as a part of the QI as to how much the satisfaction will improve.
We have done some on this online registration, and survey was done amongst the patient about what they feel about this. And, so done partly, and for indoor patients there was a thesis done on satisfaction level, but naturally there is more needs to be done.
So, sir, there is Anurag, and then there is a question from Bhopal.
I congratulate the entire team and Professor Mishra. And so, we need to spread your wings now and include other important, larger areas of the hospital. And I suggest outpatient care, infection control, and it could also be massage.
Thank you, Anurag. So, there is a question, sir, from Bhopal. Please ask your question.
Ms. Bhopal, Asif. Hello? Asif.
So I think there is still connectivity issue. This is second time we are doing, and I'm very sure this will get set as we do more and more connection with the other center.
What I would request now that the new batch of postgraduates have joined it. So what I would request, most departments have now got more of new postgraduates.
Jesus.
So one or two must be given a QI project. This is one I have also unit 4, and one or two postgraduates must be given a QI project across the department. That will I think Dr. Mishra remembers everything which I talked to him.
The chief chief of hospital pediatrician. I still remember it was Tuesday. My landing was on Monday and my study started on Monday. I said, Tuesday you are in the theater on your own. Right? The chief of hospital walks in and he's a ground consultant. He would ask me, who are you? But okay, fine, good morning, sir. What happens? Everything happens. There are less number of people there. So the knee is open. And finally, I see a lot of them. The knee is open. The implant is open. And they realize the instruments are of a different kind. This happens. And then I sat back and I said, you can hardly open. They will not open. So I'm being honest. And Dr. Mishra has given enough this thing to be honest. And as I fought back and went, the surgeon was told, the chief of orthopedics was told that the instruments are wrong. He said, okay, phone up, how can you get it fast? And then they said, back in touch. They said, fine, there's a flight from Auckland after every 15 minutes, we get it from Auckland. That's done there. After 20 minutes, another phone call, Auckland has a bad weather, there are no flights for 3 hours. The case is closed. It is documented that the instruments were different. And I was told, wake up the patient, we want to talk to him. He was fine, you come back again, they put a spacer and go. Next week, again the security goes to the same theater, the same person, and I walk him in, I take him in, and he said, just a minute, you've got the same person, same patient, I said, it's just that one, I'd like to talk to John. So John is the orthopedics. He normally comes in there because he stays in a far off place. So I said, John, are you sure the instruments are okay? There was a mistake committed. The patient was told about it. The patient accepted it. It happens. This is where we have to have this kind of honesty and transparency that we know. You see, if you read your other governor's books, complication and all that stuff, anything discussed in CGR is not open for legal implications. Yes, that's a fact. In 1994, we started a anonymous case. I'm sorry to say, I was told, don't put anything in through genetic. Because people can't spread a message that I committed a mistake. Self-reporting is the one. Thank you, sir.
And all these inquiries should not lead to any penalization. Thank you so much.
That's why New Zealand is one country where they have done this no-fault compensation. That has been a mistake. May not be a fault of the doctor, it's not a fault of the patient either. The patient has suffered, how will you compensate? I think that is something very, very important. That's the no-fault compensation that you don't recommend. There was a mistake, accepted, you correct that mistake. By reprimanding or by punishing, you may not be able to do that. But that mistake should not happen again. I think that is where we need to learn, so that mistake does not happen. And that is where reporting becomes important. And that is why the trauma center now incident reporting is on for a few years now. So every incident is reported. And it's doing very well. And that is something we need to learn and practice. And what Dr. Anjan said, instead of the reversal, the muscle relaxant, it is not uncommon mistake. It happens. If you are no SOP, if you don't label the drug, it happens. That is where we have to see that how in a ward, in a surgical ward, the jejunostomy beam goes into the central line. It happened. In Institute it happened. 600 milligram of diclofenac was given to the remember. So the things happen. Don't think that these things don't happen and they can happen to you, to me, to anyone. If we don't correct ourselves, and that's what Madam said, we have to correct ourselves, otherwise others will tell you to correct. And then you will have a greater problem. The others tell you, the media tells you, if the politician tells you, if the courts tell you, it's a serious problem.
Thank you.
Either profession itself. This is only the beginning. What I would request each one of you, think about quality improvement, wherever you are, whichever capacity you are working, think about the quality, the way you talk to the patient, the way you talk to your colleague, the way you talk to the nurses talk to the doctor. Everything is quality. That will reduce the chances of error.
whether it's in gut, whether it's the dose, whether it's the procedure. Fortunately, in India, wrong operations are not so commonly done because we know the patient. We know which patient I am going to operate. It happens in USA. But there are wrong procedures are undertaken. We have reached this specialization. So many areas for improvement in every hospital. And that is where the regular quality improvement programs are an essential part of the system. And we must have SOPs on every procedure, every department. That is where we have to go. To avoid, we should not be taken by surprise on table. Oh, this patient has come on table with this. What do we do? That is something.
Thank you one and all for coming for this grand round. And nodding to Aparna and Sindhu.
We'll have another go.
We'll go a quarter.